Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
What was the word, church, 4 years ago before we started the building campaign? God gave me a word for the year. It was what? Okay. And the next year it was what? Harvest time again. And the next year, okay. The first year was what? The next year was what? The third year was what? Who said outpouring? You need to stand up and give yourself a hand clap. It was outpouring. Praise the Lord. Remember, outpouring was go back and pick up every prophetic word that God had ever given you. Pick it back up, because the Bible says, so shall my word be that goes forth. It will not return void, but it'll accomplish that where I send it and prosper wherever it goes. And this year, it's what?
Blessed.
Blessed. How blessed are you?
Big time. Blessed.
Say, no, just say it.
Blessed. Blessed.
Now, what is the enemy's job to do with the word? Steal it. So if you couldn't remember that, if you couldn't remember what was emphasized, I want you to understand something very clearly. You've been robbed. It's nothing like somebody breaking into your house, something being stolen. You don't know it's stolen. And then they break in again. They steal something else. You don't know it's stolen. The way the enemy steals is kind of like that, where no alarm goes off that something is missing, but yet still something is missing. We have to let the word of God dwell in us richly. He is trying to blind our minds lest we could see the glorious light of the gospel of Jesus Christ and all of the promises. So I want to help us realize that when you can get a revelation of the word, you can get the benefits of that word. That everything that I do in this church is primarily based off of God telling me something. One of the gifts to this body is that I don't have a great deal of trouble hearing the thus saith the Lord. So those things and those phrases that God gave me to just really kind of show you a word picture of what he was doing in those particular years and times were gifts to us. Now, when he says you're blessed this year, he says, behold, I put before you blessing and curse and life and death. Choose life. Choose blessing. The blessing is that you have a choice. You have a choice. So God showed me a word picture for our word today about blessed. And it was a cloud right here with rain, and then it was a dry space. And I was standing in the dry space, and the rain was over there. And he said, Jane, why are you standing here when I want you to stand there? Because that's, Lord, I don't want to get wet. And sometimes because we don't like the position and the circumstances of which the blessing is poured out on us, we opt out of the blessing and say, it's all right here in Egypt. Because the blessing that takes me on a journey through the wilderness to the promised land, I don't really like that. It's better in Egypt. They kind of just give you good welfare. I want to be taken care of. Now, God has a season where he just does everything for you. And then he knows that you were born to work. You were born to do something of significance. So in doing something, you feel alive. In doing nothing, you feel taken care of. And God knows that over time, you complain about the manna that's coming from heaven. And you want some quail. Well, people who take care of you don't get a lot of choices. Tell my kids all the time, I have money, you don't. I'm prosperous, you're broke. Y'all don't be asking, you know, you don't decide. They say, we want, one day they had the nerve to tell me this. All of a sudden, that nerd tell me, Dad, we want, I said, let's go to, you know, Chick-fil-A. They said, let's go to Stony River. I said, the last time we went, we had gift cards. We don't have gift cards to be going to Stony River. They naming that like that's, you know, getting some McDonald's. No, that's like special occasion. You know, you don't understand money. You have to tip. We don't have to tip Chick-fil-A. Totally off the subject. The rain cloud. Help me, Jesus. Rain cloud here. Why are you standing over there? Because I don't want to get away. So I wanted you to know, as we talk about the promise today or the blessing today, It has a location. When God says something, it is what he says. He has not changed, nor has the location of where you pick up your gift changed. But you and I may be out of alignment. And therefore, you cannot get the assigned endowment. Today, I want to help you understand how the early church aligned itself for the ultimate blessing, God the Holy Spirit. This is a promise to all those who believe. In fact, Acts chapter 2 says it this way. This promise, this gift of the Holy Spirit is for you, for your children, for your children's children, and for all those who are far off, and as many as call upon the name of the Lord. Look at Galatians 3, 13 and 14. One of my friends is in the room right now. One of her favorite scriptures is this. She's a preaching machine. Now, I can't wait till she preaches again. Kim Church. This is her favorite scripture. One of them. Verse 13. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree, so that in Christ the blessing of Abraham might come to the Gentiles, so that we might receive the promised Spirit through faith. Blessing of Abraham involves the promise of Christ, the extending of an invitation to you to be in the spiritual family of God, because you are estranged spiritually. You are born spiritually dead, but you get invited in through this blessing. But the blessing, if you only take the gift of salvation and you leave out the gift of the empowerment of God, the Holy Spirit. He said the promised Spirit, showing a distinction between the covenant that would bring salvation. Why would you get one thing and move out of the rain cloud? Why don't you stay there long enough to get everything? That's just like saying you serve God long enough to get a bill paid, then you do whatever you want to do. You serve God long enough to feel like the sins that you felt like you were going to die from, and then you get a little distance from when you don't feel like you're going to die anymore, then you can go back to sinning again because God gave you enough word to let you know that he loved you and he forgive you, and you move on. But then you start feeling comfortable again and you start sinning again, you know, and then you feel convicted and you stop doing the sin for a minute, but then you go back, you know. Anybody know that cycle? Okay. The promise. So we're now going to look at Acts 2. The first 11 verses, and we're going to see when God fulfilled this first promise, the context, the positioning by which it came. We're also going to look at who were the beneficiaries of this blessing. We'll see one set of beneficiaries who had a dynamic internal experience that became external, and then those people around them began to become beneficiaries of the blessing that was on their life. Their word came to all these people around them. And then a pattern was set up where when you activate that inward promise, people can be blessed through your preaching. So we're going to talk about the promise, all the people that get a benefit from the promise, including yourself, and then how to dispense this on a regular basis is through preaching and seeing how they did it. Okay, let's go Acts 1. And let's start. Bye. I love kids. I think, Pastor Mike, we should bring back children's special time where back in the day, we used to bring all the kids down the front and you know, kind of teach them and stuff like that. Isn't that cute? Oh, okay. All right. Acts 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. Obviously, the day of Pentecost means 50. This is the day or 50 days from the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus actually died during Passover. You remember, and Jesus dying on Passover was significant because this was the sign that they were going to be delivered from Egypt and cut off from their enemies, that God was solving a major problem they had, and the blood was put on the doorpost. And then the Bible calls him our lamb, so he was our Passover lamb. And you can see a correlation between the Old Testament feast and the prophetic announcement of Jesus' death, burial, his resurrection, and leading to the 50 days, what we call Pentecost, where there's going to be an outpouring of God's Spirit and the birthing of a new age of the church, and how what's inside the church is going to become upon the church in order to preach to other people. The day of Pentecost had arrived. They were together in one place. Let's just talk about together. They were together. They were together. They were really together. They weren't fake together. They weren't tolerating one another. They weren't just dealing with their differences. They weren't just dealing, you know, and saying, well, since God has made me do this, I'm going to do this. They had a line of the hearts. They had a line of minds. They had a spiritual emphasis that was the same. No one was accusing Peter, for instance, of being the guy who denied Jesus after being the closest to Jesus and doing all of the boasting. They wasn't saying, now, Peter, you need to be outside of the camp. They was including him. John wasn't standing up saying, Peter, why are you talking so much? Because I should be the one talking. He, after all, left me mother, you know, the mother, you know, he left me the family. So I should be talking to Peter, and you always talk too much. And they weren't, and John wasn't saying, you know, I brought you into this thing in the first place. You wouldn't know Jesus if it wasn't for me. It wasn't a lot of that. By the way, Jesus' mother is there when they are in one place, on one accord. They're in an upper room. We think this upper room would be the same upper room that Jesus actually did the Lord's Supper in. It was a big upper room because it can hold 120 people. The Bible says in Acts chapter 1 that the mother of Jesus and the brothers of Jesus was there right there. And that's when you know that you're going to have some problems, some legal battles over the inheritance of the word of God. You know, family, I know what the covenant says. I know what the testament says. I know what the will says, but I'm letting you know, I'm his mama, give me a place. I'm his brother, give me a place. I want you to know they were together. You know human nature. When somebody dies, everybody fighting over the stuff. There was no boasting of Jesus' mother. You know I need a special holy place in the church's birthing because after all, I'm his mother. There was no indication with her being there or the other family members that they were given some eternal seats of prominence. Yet they were given what everybody should be given, respect. Respect was there. Honor was there. And so I want you to understand that you've seen a transition when you see the day of Pentecost and that they were together. You see that the language of the Old Testament was talking about, you know, tents and tribes. And now he's going to shift to a language of the body of Christ. This together is deep. This together is like John 17 when Jesus prayed, Lord, I pray you make them one as we are one. I want them to get the endowment of the Spirit according to Ephesians 1. Or the engagement ring of the Spirit. Or the earnestness of the Spirit. The proof that they are born again is that I give them a born again regenerated spirit by adding my spirit to their spirit that they can cry out, we are the sons of God. This is called the indwelling of the Spirit. He had breathed on them. They were in one accord. They weren't in doctrinal discord. They weren't saying, well, you know what the baptism meant. We need to get some water around here. We got to get a. They weren't fighting with each other. You've got to understand this. And they had some things that being humans, they could be fighting about. I'm thinking about all the arguments I would have had. Like, I'm not going to be in the same room with Peter. For him to, we our lives on the line, and they try to stone me, and then Peter going to run off on me too? You have to, you'll put yourself in context. They've overcome some stuff to align themselves under the cloud to get a promise of the Spirit. Verse, let's keep going. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind and filled the place where they were sitting. A couple of things here. There came something that's from heaven. And it was a sound. It wasn't a wind. It was like a wind. It was like a rushing mighty wind. And what is a rush and mighty wind like? It's powerful. It's invisible. It's something you can feel, but you cannot see. So you don't want to get in church when somebody, don't get weirded out when somebody say, ooh, I feel the Spirit. And I'm not weird some people out. Like, what y'all, I don't feel nothing. Trying to make me feel something. Them people just talking. No. It's invisible. And you know, when you, this feeling, it says it fills the room. It's helping you understand the unity that they had produced a spiritual unity of every corner of the room being filled. Now, you hear people say, the presence of the Lord is here. I feel the presence of the Lord. Now, first of all, the presence of the Lord is always here. What they're identifying with is the multiplied entrance and move of God the Holy Spirit. He's starting to get ready to do something. Remember how they work together? Because we believe, here's what I get, we believe in one God that eternally exists in three persons: God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. There are things about God the Father that seem to be characteristic of his, like, creator. There are things about God the Son, which is like the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And now Jesus has ascended, that God the Holy Spirit can take up residence in men. There is a cooperation, but yet the three are one. They're not separate. You don't worship three gods. Like, I gotta build a temple for him. I gotta build a temple. It's just one. But that's a mystery. You don't understand it. How can it all happen? You can't understand everything. But this is how God describes himself. And he says, here's the version of myself. Here's the part of me. They're sent to comfort you. They're sent to bless you. They're sent to empower you. They're sent to bring back everything to your remembrance. And they're about to be clothed with what's on the inside already. Jesus, what's on the inside already? God the Father, what's on the inside already? God the Word, all in one. But now the emphasis is going to be God the Holy Spirit, not just in you, but upon you. And now they're starting to feel these external things that come, not because of them begging for something. We don't even hear them asking for anything. All we see them doing is aligning doctrinally, aligning emotionally, getting rid of bitterness and getting rid of fear and getting rid of doubt. And they're praying every day and they're worshiping every day. And sometime that they didn't know, suddenly there came a sound from heaven. Okay, I'm out. That's a rushing mighty wind. And the Spirit filled the place where they were sitting. Now, watch this next part, lest you limit God to something. I'm going to prevent that limiting. He's beyond man's, what's the stopping time on this service? I forgot. I was happy, so you know. Just let me know at some point. Hope you get it wrong. Verse 3. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now let's just deal with it. Let's start with the divided tongues of fire. Spooky, isn't it? A little scary almost. When Jesus came out of the water after he was initially baptized, the Bible says the Spirit descended upon him like a dove. And the scripture also says that God had previously told John that this would be a sign to you that this is the one. Never again have I heard of the Spirit descending, not said a kitten, on somebody like a dove. In the same way, this cloven tongues of fire does not appear again in Scripture as a part of an ongoing experience that is necessary, but it was an authentic experience. It was a powerful supernatural experience. It was a great expression, but it is in nowhere in need of repeating nor dismissing. But it does give you an example that when one is filled with the Spirit of God, that there are external things that could happen which might not have pure meaning or explanation right away, but should not be easily dismissed. So, because remember, their unity, not their differences, caused an outpouring. They finally waited. So when you see some people say they get filled with the Spirit and they got a shake on them, and a little breathing, don't get weirded out by that. When the runners start running, wow! Don't get weirded out. When the jumpers start, when the stoics start weeping, ooh, I don't know what your experience has been or will be. What we look for is something decent in order. It can be authentic. There's no need to repeat something that's not germane to your who you are. And that means it would be natural. You don't have to look toward what people have done in the past and say, ooh, when you're spiritual, your knee buckles. When you're spiritual, you go on a wave that you can't see. You do not build a doctrine based on a unique one-time experience, but you can get insight that there are experiences that happen. Cloven tongues, like us on fire, appeared on each of them, and they were filled. Isn't that funny? The conjunction. There was external experience, but yet there was an internal filling with the authentic God in your born-again spirit pours more of himself in, that your treasure in earthen vessel no longer has capacity to withhold just on the inside, but now what's on the inside comes on the outside, and it completely submerges you like you are in baptism until you are clothed with the Spirit of Almighty God for a purpose. Spirit is upon them. And yes. Okay. Notice that it is the Spirit that gives utterance. The Spirit of God does not need your help in a traditional way where you need to hear something someone else has done and you need to try to figure out how to mimic it. No, you need to imitate their disposition of unity and prayer and worship, and then the suddenly that they didn't even understand can come upon you. Notice that they were sitting. And I know that life has come down to how many people we can get to the front of a room to do something. But they was just sitting there in unity, worshiping God. That suddenly came in an invisible way. Stuff started appearing on the room. And before they know it, they were speaking in an unknown tongue to them, but a known tongue to those who were standing by. So they start speaking Spanish, but they only knew Greek. They were Galileans. The spirit experience they were having was the initial promise that it's not limited to just one thing, though we do find patterns. They were sitting. They wasn't running for it. He wasn't trying to weigh down God to get attention. I got a praise ain't nobody had, Lord. Nobody does this two-arm praise. They were sitting. There seems to be a comfort about their empowerment of the Spirit. There seems to be a, I'm all right with the unknown things, but what I'm going to focus on is, I'm not mad at you that I'm worshiping with. I'm not mad at God that I'm here to serve. In fact, he's the Lord of my life, and the only thing he owes me is, I owe him is my worship. He owes me nothing. I owe him everything. I'm not mad that they asked for offerings and tithes. I'm not mad that they asked us to go on mission. I'm not mad that they tell us to live holy. I'm only happy that I know God, and he owes me nothing else. And it seems to be when you just wait on him and with all the expectation that he needs to deliver you some more stuff, the promise comes. Holy Ghost and filling you. And then the Bible commands in Ephesians 5, once you find that place, keep being filled with the Spirit. He said your alternative is going to be to be and drunkenness, intoxicated with reality TV, which is no reality at all. If the camera is on you and they say action, it's not reality. It's just free flow, impromptu acting. That's dominating your life to watch somebody else's life. But you need to watch the life of Christ. You need to live life. Get out of your house, sit your TV and live life. God is wanting you to occupy. Get around people, real people, authentic people. Get out of the lie. The devil's trying to blind your mind with stuff that doesn't even matter, doesn't even work. You can't feel God move because you won't let God in. But give him a place by getting in unity with the body of Christ. Stop talking about other Christians and you know that other church. No, that's your body. That's if they hurt, we hurt. If they're blessed, we're blessed. We're all in it together. Don't you understand? The Spirit comes to unify us, not divide us. And because they had that unity, they spoke, and the Bible says there were God-fearing Jews from everywhere, and they came, you know, the Persians, the Medes, and all these folk, and they heard in their own language them speaking the word of God and about the kingdom. And they said, how can this be? These brothers are fishermen, uneducated, and they're not from where we are to be speaking our tongue. But the empowerment of the Spirit was given for God to prove that this gospel is for all the world. This message is for all the world. And from the day he sent the empowerment, he's making a proclamation. It won't be limited to the Jews. It won't be limited to those who understand Greek. It won't be limited to those who understand what Galilee was like. No, this is for everybody. This is for you, your children, your children's children, and as many as are far off. And they begin to preach. I just rolled 2 points together for those who take notes. I put people and preaching together. Praise them. And he says in verse 11, halfway through, we hear them telling us in our own tongue the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, what does this mean? But others mocked and said, they fill with new wine. Every time there's an outpouring of the Spirit, there are people that get clothed with the power who are beneficiaries. There are people that are near where the power has fallen who become beneficiaries. And there's always something demonic trying to suggest that the good God is doing is actually something bad. They drunk in church. They crazy. Don't nobody, they couldn't see. That's supernatural. Your common sense to tell you, man, it's 120 of them. We from all over the world. All of us hear our own language plus the language of the day. This is amazing. This is power personified, not capsule. God is not capped to your little altar experience. There'll be more outpourings of the Spirit where they spoke the word boldly, where they laid hands on the sick and they recovered, where they spoke with the tongues of angels. They spoke, according to 1 Corinthians 14, the mysteries of God. And their mind couldn't comprehend it, but their spirit was saying. Now, you tell me. If God is offering himself and some free stuff along with it, do you want somebody who thinks you a crazy drunk, who rejects the miracle they're seeing, to determine whether or not you're going to get under the cloud and get the blessing? Do you want your past disposition about spiritual things that may have been spooky or weird, and I'm just going for the normal Christ stuff, not the extraordinary stuff. You want to get stuck there. He is not forcing you, nor does this, if they said no to this, did it take away from their authentic Christian experience that gives them the rights to eternal life. But what happened was, after the Spirit was poured out for all people, it all clicked. Peter starts standing up saying, "Sir, are these people not drunk? Like you suppose?" This is what the Old Testament prophet Joel was talking about. In the last days, he's going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see dreams, and old men shall have visions. He's saying a supernatural thing is going to happen. He's preaching now. The end result of all of his preaching is people got saved, baptized, added to the church, and people start getting filled with the Spirit. But here's the point for you today. If Christ is in you, the hope of glory, don't limit yourself to a dry Christian experience when the blessing over us this year is for a Holy Ghost-filled people with an authentic experience that have gift after gift after gift after gift going forward for the benefit of people coming into the kingdom. If you want a gift of healing to work through you so you can say, "You mom, mama, I'll work me a miracle today," you're missing it. But if you want the gifts available to you that they might be better tools for you to do the work of being a witness, then you've wished a good thing. You prayed a good thing. Stand to your feet. In the upper venue, stand to your feet. Whether you're in the upper venue today or watching by line, the ministry team, you can come down, or you're in this sanctuary. God has extended to you a promise. And that's him and you. That's saying yes to him and getting born again. If you need to get born again today, I want you to come. Being filled with the Spirit is not about, you can ask. The Bible says everyone that asks for the Holy Spirit, he gives. You can come to our class this Wednesday night and learn. You can come to Wednesday night service and tear. And not, well, we don't believe in tearing because you just get it. But you can come and search. But know this, that there's something dynamic that happens when you're interested in unity and alignment with heaven and with the body of Christ. It automatically, without you doing anything, causes an outpouring of God's Spirit. Church, I beg you to be in alignment with Christ. Be in alignment with one another, that you might receive the ultimate promise, the ultimate blessing, that you might be a distribution center of the gospel and blessings of the Spirit to others. God, I pray as we leave this place, you go with us. You will keep us in the center of your will, in the apple of your eye. And we'll give you praise for all things in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need you, my Savior. I believe you died for me. I believe you were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that you are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.
Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.